Mountains of Mecca, what can you say of the day that Abraham passed your way? And he was instructed by God to build a house of peace where people will pray, and they will come on every lean camel and out of every ravine for the purpose of praising Allah, to glorify Allah. O mountains of Mecca, what can you tell of the day that stones from the sky fell, destroying an army determined to break the house of Allah that Abraham built? O mountains of Mecca, how was the dawn on the day that my prophet Muhammad was born? How did it feel knowing he was to be the last and most beloved of all, Rasul of Allah, Nabi of Allah? O mountains of Mecca, you were there when the Prophet Muhammad climbed down in despair. Engraved in his heart were the words of his Lord to all of mankind. This was his call: La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. O people, praise only Allah, glorify Allah. O mountains of Mecca, how did you mourn on the day that the beloved returned to his Lord? And up till the last breath escaped from his lips, he prayed that his ummah would find success. O mountains of Mecca, how will it feel when the earth shall quake and tremble with fear, and we shall be gathered together to stand in the court of Allah with our deeds at hand? Oh, how we pray that on that day we'll be with those to whom Allah will say, peace be with you, I am pleased with you. O mountains of Mecca, bear witness that I to the oneness of Allah do I testify. For all that He's given me, how can I deny? My purpose in life should be only to cry, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah, Muhammad is His messenger. La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah, Muhammad is His messenger.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن سار على دربهم واتبع طريقهم ومنهجهم إلى يوم الدين. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل الله فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عليه أفضل الصلاة والسلام عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله، اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما ثم ما بعد All praise is due to Allah The beneficent, most gracious, most merciful, we praise you. We seek His help and we seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness. We seek refuge in Allah from the evil of ourselves and the evil of our actions. Whomever Allah guides, none can misguide. And whomever Allah leads astray, none can guide. I bear witness that there is no God or deity worthy worship, but one God, Allah the Almighty. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his slave and messenger. I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the final messenger. I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has brought him to lead people from darkness into light, from ignorance into knowledge. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the brother of Jesus, Moses, Ibrahim, and Noah. And I bear witness that all their message was the same. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has come to reconfirm the message of Jesus. And Jesus has come to reconfirm the message of Moses. And Moses has come to reconfirm the message of Ibrahim. And Ibrahim has come to confirm the message of Noah. And as Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-anbiya ukhwa wa deenhum wahid. The brothers, the prophets are brethren and their religion is one. They all conveyed one message. Worship one God and disbelieve in all false deities and gods. All you who believe, fear Allah. Abstain from what is impermissible. Abstain from what is prohibited. Abstain from what harms you. Fear Allah the fear that He deserves. And only die in state of total submission to Allah and to Allah alone. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase our iman. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that every second that we spend in this blessed gathering, that there'll be angels that will be witness for us the day of resurrection. And that every second will find it heavy in the scale of good deeds the day of judgment. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, look around you and acknowledge that the brothers around you are your brothers in Islam. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةً Indeed, verily, the believers are brothers. Sisters, look around you. They are all your sisters in Islam. And if you don't believe in this, well then you have no faith. Our family is approximately 1,300,000,000 Muslims around the world. They are all your brothers and sisters. And we need to understand this. We must sense this belonging that we Muslims, alhamdulillah, fall back into. Brothers and sisters in Islam, I've chosen for you a topic which is forgiving. Forgiving. Forgiving others. We know that a person that has good character and etiquettes, they follow the greatest man that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent to mankind. And they are the prophets. The greatest character that a person can have is forgiving others. When a person forgives, their faith increases and the relationship between them and others inshallah, will become better. We as Muslims need to learn to forgive others for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You'll find those people who don't forgive, they always remember the fault of others, and it might reach a level of hatred, enviousness, and they might get cut off from the rest of the people. The people who have this disease of enviousness and hatred, and they don't forgive people, eventually they'll be living by themselves. They'll be mu'tazileen min al-nas. They'll be secluded away from people. The people who have this disease, they're expecting perfection from other people. You will never be a successful person. Because Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Kullu ibn Adam khata." Every son of Adam makes mistakes and commits sins. So if you are not to forgive this person who wronged you, and this person who wronged you, and this man who wronged you, and this woman who wronged you, and this wife who wronged you, and the son that has wronged you, and your mother, you will have a major, major problem. A Muslim must strengthen the heart muscles. As a person, sometimes if they have weakness in their hand or their legs, they train to strengthen themselves. If they have a weak immune system, they will eat certain food or they'll take certain vitamins and tablets so they can strengthen the immune system. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the heart is also in need to strengthen the muscles of the heart. And one of the muscles that you need to strengthen is to train yourself, discipline yourself to forgive others. Because when you are the type of person that you forgive, you'll find the people around you are comfortable. If you are a director of a company, a principal of a school, a father, a mother that does not forgive, you'll find that you are burning yourself. When you forgive, you are less likely to go through depression and anxiety and bipolar. If you learn to forgive, if you are easygoing, if you turn a blind eye, if you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide that person who wronged you, you will be a winner. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said an amazing verse in the Quran. If I was to ask you a question, would you like that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you? Who is sensible or so-called and intelligent enough to say, no, I don't want that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves me? Everyone wants Allah to love you. Listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, وَالَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Listen to these amazing characteristics that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains to us, verifies to us, highlights these amazing characteristics that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said Allah loves them. Those who give to those who are in need at a time of comfort and at a time of ease. I'm sorry, at a time of comfort and at a time of difficulties. And those who control their anger. And unfortunately, anger seems to attract young men more than young women. And that's why Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, this hadith, which I think it found Abu Dawood, he said, "Man kadhama ghaydan wa huwa qadir an yunaffidhuhu da'ahu Allah yawm al-qiyamati ala ru'us al-khala'iq أن يخيره بأي حور شاء. هذا سلام هسي. Whomever controls their anger, while they are able to counterattack, they are able to rebel. For example, someone abused me, I'm able to abuse him. Someone hits me, I'm able to hit that person. But I control my anger for the sake of Allah. Someone abuses my father, for example, I'm not going to go down to his low position. No. A Muslim is not like this. Muhammad said, Al-Muslim laysa bisabbab, wala ta'an, wala tahash, wala badi. Muhammad has said, Muslim does not abuse others, does not yell and scream. He's not abusive. He doesn't say foul words. Muhammad has said, he tells that a Muslim does not behave in this manner. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Muhammad said, the person who controls his anger, while this person is able to rebel, Allah would call him the day of judgment. Just imagine that. Allah would call you the day of resurrection. Amongst all the people, he would call you by your name. And he would say, choose any woman of paradise that you wish. Why did Muhammad say to men? Because men are more likely to crack up, lose their temper, and do something that is haram. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows to go back to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said. وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْرِ, those who control their anger. وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ, and those who forgive people. وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ, Allah loves the good doers. Allah loves those who pardon people. If you don't forgive, you will burn yourself within. And I want you to understand something. Do you think that person who wronged you is not going to cause any wrongdoing? He'll be an abnormal person. If you forgive people, you will maintain good relationship with people. But if you cut ties with this person who wronged you, and this person who wronged you, and this person who wronged you, you'll be alone. And you'll be isolated. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislikes this character. Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam has said, اِدْفَعْ بِالسَّيِّئَ حَسَنًا تَمْحُهَا وَخَالِقْ النَّاسِ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ. Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam has said, push for which is better. If someone wronged you, don't do the same wrongdoing as that person is doing. Push for which is better. اِدْفَعْ بِالَّذِي أَحْسَنٍ فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, push for which is better. If someone abuses you, don't abuse him. Just ignore him. Don't go down to his low position. Allah Azza wa Jalla has said, اِدْفَعْ بِالَّذِي أَحْسَنْ فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ. And as for the person that you have hatred and enmity between you and him, if you push for which is better, كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ, he becomes like a great close friend. If you do better, if you push for which is better, this enemy of yours becomes a friend of yours. But if you're going to retaliate in the same manner as he has or she has, well then you're going to have a major, major problem. I beg those brothers and sisters who are married also to learn to forgive. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, وَلَا تَنْسُوا الْفَضْلَ بَيْنَكُمْ, don't forget the good deeds and the good things that has happened between you and him. Husband and wife. Wife and husband. Because there are people that, unfortunately, they always say, I'm not going to forgive you. I remember you did such and such 7, 8, 10, 15 years back. Don't you want that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you? Start to forgive people. How can I forgive someone? If someone has not wronged me, how can I forgive him? I have to forgive a person that wronged me. Once a brother approached me and said, Abu Hamza, I forgive you. I said, may Allah reward you, but have I wronged you? He said, no, but I'll just forgive you anyway. Forgive me if I've wronged you. And I ask all the brothers here and sisters, if I've wronged anyone, please forgive me. And by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whomever has wronged me, I forgive you. We need to discipline ourselves. We need to have the quality of a Muslim. That's how you'll be superior. Forgiving, it increases your faith and it will lead to paradise. Again, forgiving others, it'll increase your faith and it would lead to paradise. Not forgiving, it would lead to decrease your faith and you will end up burning yourself, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not like these characteristics that this person has. This is something that we need to keep in mind, my dear brothers and sisters. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى الله سبحانه وتعالى has said in Al-Quran, وَإِن تَعْفُوا أَقْرَبُ لِلتَّقْوَى. If you forgive, then you are near piety. Every one of us searches and strives to lift their status and position. And that position is called piety, taqwa. You want to attain that position by forgiving others. وَلَا تَنْسُوا الْفَضْلَ بَيْنَكُمْ وَلَا تَنْسَوُ الْفَضْلَ بَيْنَكُمْ. Don't forget the good deeds that have happened between you and others. And this is something that we need to keep in mind. This friend of mine, we've been friends for a lengthy period of time. If I've wronged him or he wronged me, he doesn't remember the good deeds. He just remembers the bad deed that happened between me and him. That's wrong. That is so wrong. I need to look at the good things, because the shaitan wants to huff and puff and wants me to always remember the bad deed that this person has done. And wallahi, you'll never be a successful amir, nor a president, nor a father, nor a mother, nor a director, if you always have this envious in you. If you always recall and remember a wrongdoing of a brother and a sister. You say, this brother, 7-8 years back, he did such and such. And this burns you, this will burn you. You are self-destroying yourself when you, a'udhu billah, always seem to have that hatred and at the same time not forgive other people's faults. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. فَمَنْ عَفَى وَأَصْلَحَ فَأَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. And whomever عَفَى, forgives, وَأَصْلَحَ, and reconciled, then his reward is from Allah. Please pay attention, my dear brothers and sisters. We Muslims, whatever we do it for the sake of Allah. A sister called me yesterday. And she said to me, Abu Hamza, I do my utmost best to please my husband. But my husband is a person that does not appreciate it, and he does not acknowledge the good deeds that I do for him. So as she said to me, she said, Abu Hamza, he works many hours and he works 7 days a week. She said, all I want from him is to show some gratitude so that we can have a better relationship. She said, I've tried once to send him an SMS on numerous occasions that I love you, I miss you, I can't wait till I see you, you're the best thing that has happened to my life, something around these lines. And the brother, when he saw her, he said, why are you wasting your time? Now she's devastated and she's frustrated and angry. I said, sister, I do agree that your husband is a cold man. He's a man that shows no gratitude. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide him. May Allah make him a better husband. I said, I agree with you that he's wrong. But I said, if you are doing this for the sake of Allah, you would not be as hurt as you are at the moment. Brothers and sisters, this is the level of faith that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we reach. I want to help this brother, and I want to assist this brother even if he wrongs me. So I've told the sister, please, I want you, when you do a good deed to your husband, I want you to do it for the sake of Allah. So if your husband, inshallah, treats you in an appropriate manner, alhamdulillah. But if he doesn't, you will not be as hurt because you are doing it for the sake of Allah. And the hardest act that a person can do is that they do something for the sake of Allah and they don't get approval from that other person. Or they don't get a thank you from that person. That's the hardest thing. Who did this, my dear brothers and sisters? I'll tell you who did this. One of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala an, his name is Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. He's a great man. But he's the greatest man after the Prophet. And he's the first person that will enter paradise after the Prophets. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, لو وضع إيمان الأمة في كفة ووضع إيمان أبي بكر في كفة لرجح إيمان أبو بكر. اللهم ارضى عنه. حسن سلم سيد. If the faith of the Ummah was to be placed in one hand and the faith of this man, which his name is Abu Bakr, in the other, and this is the scale, you'll find that the scale of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu's faith is greater than all the other people's faith put together. With him is Umar radiallahu anhu, Uthman radiallahu anhu, Ali radiallahu anhu, Ashabi Rasulillah, Ahlul Bayt, all the people until the day of judgment. This man, he was donating and he was taking a care of a person named Mustah. This man, he accused the wife of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, who is Aisha radiallahu anha, he accused her of a major sin, fornication. And the wife of the Prophet is the daughter of this man, which his name is Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. And then Abu Bakr has said, Wallahi, I am not going to donate nor take care of this man, Mustah. Subhanallah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descended the verse in the Quran. وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا. Let them forgive and forget. أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَن يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Don't you love that Allah forgives you? This verse of the Quran descended for Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He said, yes, I would love. And he continued on giving this man money. Forgive and forget. You want this superiority? Do you want to elevate your position? Learn to forgive others. Wallahi, once a sister wrote a letter to me. I am telling you, if you were to read this letter, if you don't have bitter faith, you will go to the Westgate Bridge. I grabbed the letter and she basically wiped the floor with me, as they say. She said every evil word that exists in the dictionary about me. Now, I could have rebelled, and I know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is putting me through a trial. When someone is abusing you out there, know that you are going through a trial. Are you going to pass the test or are you going to fail the test? So what I did is, I grabbed the letter and I threw it in the rubbish bin. Now this sister expected me to write back a letter, abusing her as she abused me. I let it go for a year. I did not reply whatsoever. Wallahi al-Azim, she sent me a letter, apologizing. With all the good words that are in the dictionary, she wrote back to me. But if I rebelled, if I transgressed towards her, If I abused her, she abused me, what would happen? What would happen? Who would be happy about this? Shaitan, Satan. With my action that I ask Allah to strengthen each one of us. She, alhamdulillah, has some respect for me. I have respect for her because she apologized. And Allah loves us. Because she apologized. And I did not rebel. And that's the way it should be. That's the way we need to train ourselves and discipline ourselves. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala forgave that man who was accusing his chaste, decent daughter, Aisha, Ummuna radiallahu anha, of a major sin. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, why do you find that people in general, they have cut ties with others? This person does not speak to this person, and this person does not speak to this person. Why? Because they are not implementing this characteristics that Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam has shown us. What an amazing story, my dear brothers. I have to say it in Arabic because the Arabic language is so rich. As-Sahabi radiallahu ta'ala an, his name is Anas ibn Malik. He was sitting down with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's the one that reports this hadith. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is sitting in the gathering and he smiles. So Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu has said, بِأَبِي أَنْتَ وَأُمِّي يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ مَا يُضْحِقُكَ. O Messenger of Allah, I'd give my mother and father for you. What is making you laugh? Why are you smiling, O Messenger of Allah? First of all, look, my dear brothers, the love that they had for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the word that they used to use at the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Arabs in general used to use this. That I would give my mother and father for you. That's how much they loved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, Allahu Akbar. He said, Ata rajulan, there were two men. At the time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has shown Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there were two men, the day of judgment they will come. قَالَ رَجُلْتَلَانِ مِنْ أُمَّتِي جَثَيَا بَيْنَ يَدَيَّ رَبِّ الْعِزَّةِ. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, two men will come the day of judgment. And they'll be standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَقَالَ أَحَدُهُمْ يَا رَبِّ خُذْ لِي مَظَّمَتِي مِنْ أَخِي. A man would say, oh Allah, take the rights of my brother. Because he has oppressed me. مَظَّمَتِي. This person has wronged me. Take, I want my rights from him. فَقَالَ لَهُ كَيْفَ تَصْنَعْ بِأَخِي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say to this person, how would it be if your brother has no hasanat? كَيْفَ تَصْنَعْ بِأَخِيكِ وَلَمْ يَبْقَى مِنْ حَسَنَاتِهِ شَيْئًا. How is it? What would you do if your brother has no good deeds at all? This man wants the hasanat, the good deeds of this person. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, how would it be if this person has no hasanat, no more? قَالَ يَا رَبْ فَلْيَحْمَلْ مِنْ أَوْزَارِ. He said, oh Allah, then allow him to take some of my sins. Allow us to stop here for a minute. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, أَتَدْرُونَ مَنِ الْمُفْلِسِ. Do you know who is bankrupt? The Sahaba replied, the person who has no dirham, no dinar. These were the currencies that was used at the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, no. He said, the bankrupt is the person that comes the day of judgment. And he has good deeds as high as the mountain. But he harmed this person. He abused this person. He stole from this person. He has backbitten this person. And everyone will take some of his good deeds. Good deeds, good deeds. Until he has no more good deeds. So this man said, Oh Allah. If he doesn't have any good deeds, but allow him then to take some of my bad deeds. Allow him to carry some of my sins that I've committed. Because that's what will happen. If I take the good deeds of this person, and this person take the good deeds of this person, and then he has no good deeds, what will happen to the other person who has rights? He will give him his bad deeds. Subhanallah. وفاضت عيناه عليه الصلاة والسلام. محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم started to cry. He started to cry. After he smiled, he started to cry. وقال إن ذلك ليوم عظيم يحتاج الناس أن يحمل عنهم أوزارهم. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this is a great day. A person would wish that his sins, his evil sins are carried by someone else. Subhanallah al-Azim. فقال الله للطالب ارفع بصرك فانظر. Muhammad alayhi salatu wa sallam continues on telling us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell this man who has been oppressed by the other man. Allah would say to him, look up, look. What can you see up there? فَقَالَ يَا رَبْ أَرَى مَدَائِن مِّن ذَهَبْ وَقُصُور مِّن ذَهَبْ مُكَلَّلَ بِاللُّؤْلُؤْ لِأَيِّ نَبِي هَذَا أو لِأَيِّ صِدِّيق أو لِأَيِّ شَهِيد هَذَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say to him, lift your head. What can you see? And he would see cities, مَدَائِن of gold, just beautiful gold.
Yeah.
And decorated with pearls. This man would say, oh Allah, who does this belong to? To which prophet does it belong to? Or which shaheed, a martyr, a person that fights for the sake of Allah? Or which siddiq, a truthful person? Who does it belong to, Allah? Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, قال لمن أعطى الثمن. Allah would say, this belongs to the person who has given the value of it. قال يا رب ومن يملك ذلك. Oh Allah, who owns this assets? Who owns these? قال أنت تملكه. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, you own this. قال بماذا؟ قال بعفوك عن أخي. He'll say, oh Allah, who owns this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you own it. He said, oh Allah, how can I own it? He said, by you forgiving your brother. You know, some of the brothers and sisters will say, I will never forgive that person. And I'll never forgive that person. This is not the right, this is not the characteristics that Allah subhanahu wants us to have. Allah wants us to forgive. Al-Hasan Basri, or Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, one of them, a person used to speak about him openly in public. So what did he do? He went and he got a box of dates and he went and knocked on the door and he said to him, here, this is a present from me. You're giving me your good deeds. I thought I should give you a present. That's how they used to be. Another amazing story, my dear brothers and sisters. And these are the people that graduated from the school of prophecy. A man by the name of Abdullah ibn Abbas. He walks into the market. And a thief would come and steal his money. And the people would gather around him. And they start cursing him. Cursing the thief. The thief took the money right away. So Abdullah ibn Abbas said, don't curse him. And he lifted his hands to the heavens. And he said, oh Allah, if this man is in need for my money, bless him with it. And he said, oh Allah, إذا كان هذا الإنسان بحاجة إلى مالي فبارك له فيها. وإن لم يكن بحاجة إليها فاجعلها آخر ذنب يرتكبه. And he said, oh Allah, if this man is not in need for my money, then make it the last sin that he commits. He made two du'a for him. If he's in need, bless him with this money. If he's not in need, oh Allah, make it that that's the last sin that this person commits. These are the Sahaba of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. These are the men that knew that wa'afu an, forgive. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inna Allah yuhibbul muhsineen. Allah forgives those good doers. This man was overwhelmed. So he took the hand of the person whom he wronged and they walked together in this amazing abode that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them. قال رسول الله اتقوا الله واصلحوا ذات بينكم. After he heard this, Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, after he narrated this hadith, he said, fear Allah and reconcile amongst one another. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يَصْلِحْ بَيْنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Allah would reconcile amongst the Muslims. This hadith, you'll find it, رواه الحاكم وهو صحيح. And also Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إِرْحَمُوا تُرْحَمُوا وَغْفِرُوا يَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ. Have mercy upon others, Allah will have mercy upon you. Forgive others, Allah will forgive you. One of the names of Allah is what? What? Ar-Rahim. And then what? Al-Ghafoor. And then what? Huh? Al-Afu. Ar-Rahim, Al-Ghafoor, Al-Afu subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the names of Allah. That Allah pardons. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, most Ibrahim alayhi salatu was salam, a man approaches him. And Ibrahim, one of the characteristics that he was known for, that he is generous and hospitable. A man that used to worship the fire, not on his door. And he asked him for some food. And Ibrahim knew that he does not worship the Creator. He said to him, go. I'm sorry, I'm not going to give you some food. When he went, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descended Gabriel. And Gabriel had said to him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, Allah has been providing for this man for 80 years. Allah is the provider. He's been providing for 80 years. And he asks you once and you say no to him? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is providing. This man has been worshipping the fire. He disbelieves in the Creator. He's been ungrateful to the Creator. And Allah has been giving him. This man asks you once and you say no? So Ibrahim ran to this person. And he said, please come back. And he said to him, what is the sudden change? Why have you changed your mind? He said, Allah has addressed me with this, telling me such and such. He said, that's the case. I bear witness that there is no God worthy of worship but one God, Allah. And I bear witness, O you, Ibrahim, that you are the messenger of Allah. Forgiving others. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, continuing on this hadith, وَيْلٌ لِأَقْمَاعِ الْقَوْلِ وَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَرِّينَ الذين يصرون على ما فعلوا وهم يعلمون. رواه أحمد. محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم continues on with this hadith. ويل لأقماع القول. محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم said, woe to those that are like funnel. You know a funnel? When you have a bottle and you put a funnel, and just imagine you have oil. What remains in the funnel? Nothing. So Muhammad said, woe to those who are like a funnel. Useless. They hear good, but they don't absorb any good. No oil remains. No water remains. Nothing remains. Woe to those who continue on being stubborn while they know the truth. ويل للمصرين الذين يصرون على ما فعلوا وهم يعلمون. Woe to those who insist in doing their evil doing when they know that they are doing evil. When a person is committing a sin, enough is enough. Don't be stubborn about it. Abstain from it. Move away from it. Don't be, my dear brothers and sisters, like a funnel. That you hear good and it goes right through one ear to through the other ear. That's exactly how it is. How many people have heard that you should treat your wife in a respectable manner? How many times have sisters heard that you should be obedient to your husband? How many brothers have heard that drugs, alcohol, smoking harms you? How many of us have heard that prayer is compulsory upon every Muslim. How many of us have heard that we as Muslims should be obedient to Allah? How many of us have heard that we should forgive others? But unfortunately we go out there and we don't obey it. We don't obey these commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many of us have heard this? Don't be like those that know the truth and don't follow it. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما زاد الله عبدا بعفو إلا عزا. Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said, the only thing that increases a slave piety and honor is to forgive. When a person forgives, then their status will be lifted by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is our example. The Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم forgave the person Labid ibn al-Asam who bewitched him. Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم had forgave the Jewish woman who put poison in his food. Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام, when he conquered Mecca, the place that he was driven out, the place that some of his friends were killed, his companions, the place that they've made a mockery out of him, abused him and accused him, he walks inside and he said, "Antum al-turaqa, you are free." Just imagine you were driven out of your land, and then you had an opportunity to actually conquer back that land. What would you do? You'd probably destroy every person that exists in this land. But Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us not to do this. That is why, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the majority of people are embracing Islam because Islam is the truth. Because when they listen to the garbage media and then they come back and read the Quran, read the biography of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they see that there's contradiction between what the media presents and what Islam is all about. That is Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, my dear brothers and sisters, conquers Mecca. And guess what he does, the first thing that he does? He goes to an old woman and he goes and speaks to her. Women are jealous. His wife wanted to find out. Regardless how old, regardless if she has teeth or no teeth, hair or no hair, if your wife sees you speak to some woman, she wants to know who the hell she is. And if she doesn't see you speak, she'd speculate. She would, wallah, there's a sister, may Allah forgive you, she's driving me crazy. I'm just about to leave counseling because of this sister. She suspects that her husband is onto someone else. And I believe that all of you would do what she's accusing him of, except for this brother. Wallahi. Obsession is a sickness. When a'yadu billah, accuse someone falsely, it is a disease. This sister has made her husband leave approximately 12 working places that he's worked at. Wallah, the guy's gone ballistic. He said, wallahi, I didn't do this. Wallah, I didn't speak. She said, I saw a dream and I believe in my dreams. If you're gonna base your life on a dream, then you're on a path of ignorance. Many people think, and this is the problem, many people think that whatever they see in their dream, it's real, it's going to happen. And many of the brothers and sisters make istikhara sometimes. And they would say, well, you know, they've been married for 20 years, I've made an istikhara, should I stay with my husband or shouldn't I? For God's sake, you've been together for 20 years. And she gets up and she says, oh, you know, I saw a black dog in my dream, and I saw a good man, a good looking man, and he said, divorce your husband. And she calls me, she said, Abu Hamza, I've made an istikhara, and that man, that good, beautiful white man with, you know, all this, he told me, divorce your husband. Don't you think I should divorce him? ما شاء الله تبارك الله. Don't you ever base your life on your dreams. A sister approaches me the other day and said, this is a problem, this is a problem. Istikhara, my dear brothers, is when you consult Allah. For example, you want to get married to a sister, and that sister, she has good character. Alhamdulillah, you've heard good things about her. She has good faith, tabarakallah. Then continue on. Make istikhara. If something happens, you know, obstacles take place or whatever, if you dislike something about her or vice versa, then you move away. But don't expect something in your dream to make that judgment. Don't expect that to happen. You are to make istikhara. A person might make an istikhara during the day. Many people think, no, I'm going to make istikhara for, you know, make two rak'ah and then I should sleep. No. If I want to get married for now, for example, I saw a beautiful girl and she saw me and, you know, we're happy. I mean, she said, excuse me, sister, I'm going to go pray two rak'ah istikhara. You pray two rak'ah istikhara, inshallah. Okay? Think about it. Ask about me. I ask about you. Within an hour, we can get married. Yalla, bismillah, Allahu Akbar. Because istikhara is made in many things, my dear brothers. Also, if you want to buy something, make istikhara. There is nothing wrong with it whatsoever. And what a beautiful hadith that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells a man named Uqba ibn Amir. Uqba ibn Amir, one of the Sahaba, radiallahu ta'ala, and he said, Ya Muhammad, he said, أخبرني بفواضل الأعمال. عقبة بن عامر, one of the Sahaba, he held the hand of the Prophet. I remember when the Sheikh came from Saudi Arabia and he held my hand in the middle of Sydney Road, mashallah. And I was turning black and blue. He doesn't know that I probably now have the people on Sydney Road. Abu Hamza, a bit of a change, huh? Then I realized that it is normal. You know, in Saudi Arabia, many friends, you know, hold the hands of others. There's nothing wrong with it whatsoever. And, you know, here I am trying to pull the hand out of the Sheikh. And he's holding on, you know, brotherhood. But here we have Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam showing us that this is part of brotherhood. There is nothing wrong with it whatsoever. But unfortunately, because there's a disease that exists out there at the moment, that people think, well, you know, homosexuals or whatever, we don't have this disease and sickness. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam held the hand of this young man, Uqba ibn Amir, and he said, O Messenger of Allah, tell me of the best of deeds that I can fulfill. Look what he said, my dear brothers. Please pay attention. He said, Sil man qata'ak. Connect with those that intend to cut you off. Your brother wants to cut you off. He doesn't want to, he wants to ignore you. Go and say, Salaam alaikum, brother. Don't allow the shaitan to, wal'iyadu billah, build a bridge between you two. I'm sorry, a barrier between you two. Sil man qata'ak. Connect with who wants to cut you off. You see a brother that wants to ignore you, you go to him, Salaam alaikum, brother. Sil man qata'ak. Subhanallah. وَأَعْطِي مَنْ حَرَمَكْ. And give whomever deprives you. Give. And who did this? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. أَعْطِي مَنْ حَرَمَكْ. You come up to someone and say, brother, can I lend $100 from you? And the brother will say yes. Okay, the brother would say yes. And you know that at that specific time you are in need for $100. And you say, brother, can I borrow $100? And you know that he's got it. He would say no to you. This is a problem. أَعْطِي مَنْ حَرَمَكْ. If he did not give you, it doesn't mean that you don't give him. Give him. وَعَفُ عَنْ مَنْ ظَلَمَكْ. And forgive whomever oppresses you. Forgive those who have oppressed you. As I said, if you want to have a sound life, if you want to have a life of prosperity, if you want to have a life of peace, forgive others. If you want to have a life of hatred and animosity, if you want to burn yourself, If you want to enter into the field of depression and anxiety, have this. Don't forgive others. If you want that Allah loves you, forgive others. If you want that the shaitan loves you, don't forgive others. And as I said, you will be a successful person if you forgive people for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All I ask you, don't treat people the way they treat you. Always treat people better than they treat you. And that's hard. It is hard. But it's worth it. Because the price of this, the reward of this is paradise by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم.